questions are there about mind and the thoughts. So I'll answer that and then we will carry on with this. So somebody has said that we must do what I call it pratyasara. You keep tracking your thoughts down to its roots to find out where it actually began. What was the original reason, the source for this thought to occur in me? Some thoughts are natural. For example, I have to eat food. That is a natural thought because your body demands it. But some thoughts, I want to eat this food only. Where did that originate from? I like this food, I don't like that food. Where did those thoughts originate from? Eating is a normal day-to-day thing. Everybody eats, from man to elephant and humans. But I want to eat this and not that. Where did that thought come from? Like this, for an example. Probably, if you start tracking it down, you had seen a picture of the food on a restaurant board. If we keep traveling, how do these people attract us to their restaurant when you're traveling on a highway? They put up nice pictures of coffee and biscuits and all kinds of, what do you call, burgers and sandwiches. So they put huge hoardings. Looking at that, a desire comes that let me eat what? Not just food. I want to eat that food which is on the billboard or an advertisement. Or you had gone to somebody's house where you ate something. You liked it so much that now there is a desire which developed that I want to eat it again and again. Like that, you keep going back and seeing where your thoughts are originating from. Because unless you remove the root of the thoughts, it's like mowing a lawn. You cut the grass, but the roots are still there. And those roots will grow back after some time. So unless you go back all the way to not just plucking the grass, but going and uprooting it from the roots, it's not going to go away. Those thoughts will keep coming back again and again because they have taken roots in your mind. They are not going to go away just by one time avoiding them or one time staying away from that distraction. Because deep down the guna is also there. That is why we said viveka are of two kinds. One is drishta anushravika, vishaya vitrishna, vashikara sanghya. Means whatever you hear or whatever you see, you develop some attachment towards that. And getting rid of that attachment or controlling that attachment, vashikara, means to keep it under your control. That state, sanghya, is called vairagya in the first place. I haven't seen the latest phone that has been released in the market. But I've heard about it from somebody who has got it. Now our desire has begun. Or I have seen it on a billboard in an advertisement somewhere, an object, a new model of phone or a computer or a shoe or anything, watch. And then now the desire has begun because I've seen it, or even if I have not seen, I've heard about it. So that is why drishta anushravika. Drishta means that which you have seen. Anushravika is that you have heard about. That's how the desire develops. By seeing something or by listening about something, we develop. It means by any other senses also. You go sit somewhere, very nice soft cushion. Now the desire starts. I should also have something like soft and nice like this. You wore somebody's chappal you borrowed and wore. That chappal was very comfortable compared to yours. Now a desire began. You smelled something good. You heard something good. You tasted something good. You saw something good. You touched something. And that's how the desire began. And even if you have not directly done it, you have heard about that from somebody who has seen, touched, tasted, smelt or felt it. That is why the desire has come, that thought has come. This is the route you have to go back. When did I first get this desire? I heard about it from a friend that a new pair of shoes released by some Nike or something has come into the market. I believe that is very good. A desire has come into you. You have shoes, not that you don't have shoes, but that shoe, that pair of shoes, which I heard about or saw it on the billboard in an advertisement, it starts like that. That is the first type of vairagya. You can get rid of it how? By avoiding to see the advertisement, by avoiding to talk about it, by avoiding to meet that fellow who put this thought in your head. These are the ways to avoid the recurrence of that thought. But that is like mowing the lawn, cutting the grass. The root, the guna part of it has already gone inside. The abhivyakti is not happening because there is no possibility. Since the circumstances don't permit, or you have yourself taken charge of your senses and not allowing them to rethink or re-engage in the contemplation of that thought. So that is one thing. But deep inside the roots, if it has taken already, then the second level of vairagya has to be practiced. What is that? It says, tat paramapurusham khyate guna vaitrishnasya. That is vairagyam. What is that? By having experienced that paramapurusha, that divinity within, that is how you give up even the idea, the desire which has got inside you, not just the physical abstinence, not just the physical avoidance of that desire, but even the mental avoidance can happen when you have experienced the truth, when you have experienced your divinity. That time alone, it is completely possible to get rid of us. So you say, I have done this mananam and whatever, and I have found out that these are the unwanted desires. And I thought that this week I got rid of them, but next week, first thing on Monday morning is that desire only in my head. Where did it come from? I thought I got rid of it. No, you got rid of it on superficial basis. You just cut the plant, but the roots were there. And therefore it grew back again. So then you should ask me, how do I get rid of the roots itself so that these desires don't come and don't trouble me at all? Because mentally I know, intellectually I know that this is not something I need. This is not something is good for my spiritual growth. This is not something that I should be wasting my time and energy and money on. I have understood that intellectually. But deep inside, I haven't gotten rid of it. It will come back again. The vasanas are called like this. These are called vasanas. Deep they are. Like the roots. Now what should I do about it? The only way is when you realize your divinity, that is when once for all you will get rid of it. Otherwise it is not possible. It's like cutting your hair. Every time it grows back, again you cut your hair. Nails. Cutting your nails every time goes back. Cutting. So what is Mahavira when he took to the path of sannyasa? Naturally, once you become a sannyasi, you have only two choices. One, you leave the hair as it is because it will keep growing and you have no concern and nobody will cut your hair. That's why most of the sannyasis have these jatas and that matted locks and long beard and all. Or otherwise, what this Mahavira did before going out, when he was a prince too, like Gautam Buddha, what he did, he cut his hair and pulled it out in five tufts. Saying that I'll pull it out from the roots so that it won't grow back and I don't have to worry about cleaning it, and while I'm doing meditation, I don't have to suffer with all these kinds of, because hair is there, if you don't clean it, lice will come, then itching will come, meditation goes, itching starts, it'll be a disturbance. So he pulled out all the hair from the root and walked away. That is the other one, from the root. How do we remove it from the root? The only way, at least Patanjali Yoga Sutra says, is Paramapurusham, tat paramapurusham khyatehi. Once you know that paramapurusha who is within you, that you are not the body, you are the divine self who is always satisfied, doesn't need anything to be happy, it is happy within itself. It won't ask for any desires, then mind will become quiet. The one who knows the truth alone becomes free of desires, completely, permanently, eternally. Else these desires will keep coming back, you are never too sure. That is why somebody said, don't call a man good till he is dead. Because anytime he can become bad. So these desires are not so easy to go if you have not realized the truth. Once you realize the truth of who you are, that is what Nachiketa is asking. That truth upon its realization makes sure that all the desires are uprooted from the roots. Like in a saline soil, no plants will grow. This is old Indian methodology where you don't want plants to grow. What do? You put some lime water or you put some salt water there. The alkaline soil it becomes, and then nothing grows there. It remains a barren land. Otherwise, every day you have to go and pluck all those things which are growing. So this is the method. What is the permanent solution? You change the nature of the soil itself. You make it incapable of growing anything. Make it barren. How does that happen? When you realize that you are Brahman, and not the body, not the mind, not the emotions, not the intellect, not this ego identification with any of these four, that is when forever the desires go away. And even if there things are right in front of you, you don't get attracted to it at all. You say, yes, that is also a thing, that is all it is. Beyond that, you don't pay any attention. The best of the food comes. You will only eat according to your hunger and the appropriateness of your eating habits. You will not just, because the one more has come, you will not just gobble it up. That kind of temptations won't come to a person who has realized the self. Why this self-realization is so important? Precisely for this reason. That this daily headache of dealing with our desires, struggling with our thoughts, controlling our emotions, will be done once for all. So who does not want a permanent solution? Everybody wants a permanent solution to things. Something is leaking in your house. You can do temporary solutions, keep putting some plaster and keep putting some, whoever plumber comes and keeps applying some sealant or something like that. Next rain, again, back. Everything is out and again starts leaking. Temporary relief comes to you by these temporary fixes. What is the temporary fix? Avoid that person, avoid that place, avoid that advertisement, avoid that book, avoid that magazine, avoid that video, avoid that audio. You can do like that. But they are only temporary fixes. It helps you definitely, at least you are peaceful for that time. But these are all temporary fixes. Tatkalika. Nahi adruvaihi dhruvam prapti. That's what it says. From the impermanent things, permanent cannot be obtained. What is impermanent? These kind of band-aid solutions are impermanent. Temporary fixes. It will come back again. That is why the permanent fix for all the desires is to realize your divinity. Because once you realize that, you are transformed into something else. Example, those who are chemists, they will know in old times there used to be alchemists. Alchemists were specialized chemists. They knew this vidya of converting mercury into gold. In India, there were many people who were like that. Whenever they run out of the money, they'll get some mercury, and by certain process, they'll convert it into gold. That is the process which most of the people followed, and with their yoga vidya or siddhi, whatever they knew, they converted. Now look at the mercury. Mercury is very poisonous. You know, if somebody has a very volatile nature, we call him, he's a very mercurial guy. Mercurial nature he has. He just goes up, like shoots up temperature and comes down. That their behavior is very unpredictable. So mercury is like that. Mercury's behavior, mercury's properties are poisonous. It's unsteady. It keeps flowing this way, that way. You can't hold it in one place. You can't catch it. Then what do? You transform it into gold by that alchemist, that methodology. Then gold, what happens is the steady one. It is not poisonous. It is very valuable. Its temperature doesn't go up and down like mercury. It does not go through the vagaries and the restlessness like mercury. But then there is a process to convert that into gold. But once it becomes gold, it cannot be converted back into mercury. It's not possible. It's not possible at all. It means the poisonous nature of this element, mercury, is when it's converted into the lustrous nature of gold, it's irreversible reaction. It cannot be reversed back. Because of which, now its nature is transformed. It's no more the same. And now it has acquired a different set of properties, very different from the previous one. So that is what happens to when you realize yourself, this lower set of qualities, I want this, I want that, without this I'm not happy, without that person I'm not happy, this is the only way I can be. All these things disappear. You are happy within yourself, by yourself. Gold shines on its own. Its very nature is luster. It doesn't need something to make it shine. It shines on its own. Its very nature is that. Likewise, a realized person alone can get rid of his desires, her desires, once for all. Till then, there is no end to this. You can keep doing, at the end of your life also, desire may pop up, and that may be the cause of all your ruin. And many people have met their ruins like that. Though they practice lots of sadhana all through their lives, avoided people, public activities, and hid in one corner. Yet at the end of it, when the real trouble came, they could not sustain it, and they fell for it. Many examples, the Vishwamitra, he did so much of penance, 1,000 years, and then what happened? Indra got worried that Vishwamitra is getting too powerful, he may become the next Indra, he may take away my throne. So Indra sent Menaka, and Menaka came and distracted Vishwamitra, herself married to him, then all the story from there. So the idea is that this desires must go away from the root. That root is only possible, that uprooting the desires once for all is possible only when you have realized your divinity. Till then there is no relief. temporary relief may be there, like you may be experiencing right now, you are a part of a good shivira, paravidya, you feel you have become better. But no sooner that you decide that you have become better, that you will realize that again the same things are back. Shoot an air gun, all monkeys disappear. Done, monkeys are gone forever, you think. Next day, they're all back. Dirting the whole place, eating your eatables, tearing your boxes. They're all back. They're never gone permanently. So our thoughts are like that. Because we shot one air, everybody's gone. All these are gone. For that day, we are so peaceful. And then next day, what happens? All the desires come back. Therefore, next day, again, you have to chant Om. Next day again, how do you chant Om? Somebody has also asked me a question. Should I chant it loud or should I chant it in my mind and whatever? See, Om is also called by name Pranava, as you heard. Pranava is that using which we can do pranama or pranoti or whatever, using which we can worship that Brahman, because otherwise there's no form to Brahman. If you tell me, give me a picture of Brahman, I want to meditate, I can't give you one. Give me a statue of Brahman, I can't give you one. So how do I meditate on this Brahman? Because I'm so used to forms and names. No, this is a sound on which you meditate. And then sound meditation also has got various aspects. When you start a part of it, that you are thinking that from silence is emerging a form and a name. In a Jagratavastha, this waking state. From deep sleep, I'm coming out. Now I've become the man or woman, whatever I am, whatever I think I am. Then I sustain through the day, I work through the day using this body as a man or a woman. Then I go into a dream state before sleeping. I am dreaming so many things. That is U. And then slowly I slip into the deep sleep state by the end of the day. And that is how I am going to the Sushupti Avastha. And after Sushupti Avastha, again there is a deep silence. And next morning again I emerge out from the deep silence and become the waking person. Then the dreaming person, then the sleeping person, and then out. So Omkara has to be meditated with this idea that is that I am not the waking state. I am not even the dream state. I am not even the deep sleep state. The last one, the silence, the fourth, that is what I am. That original substratum from which everything is emerged. The original silence from which all the sounds emerge. That is what we observed. So that we don't forget, they have made it into a nice symbol, and each part of the symbol they have represented by the wakeful dream and deep sleep state. And then we say that the fourth state above all these things is the Turiyavastha, represented by the Bindu. That is the idea. But the thing is that, how do you chant? You chant it loudly and also chant the silence. Don't forget to chant the silence. How do you chant the silence? By being silent. Our Omkar practice is what we start. We start Om. Om. The silence also you have to hear. You hear the you hear the oo, you hear the mo, and then silence you have to hear. If you miss the silence part of it, then you have not chanted Omkara properly. So should we chant it loud? Yes, you have to chant it loud. It's called Udgita in Chandogya Upanishad. It's the essence. Udgita also means chanting it loud, Gita, to sing it loud. So Omkara has to be chanted loud so that you can hear the silence. The idea is to understand the silence, therefore the sound before it. But what is to be meditated upon truly? The silence has to be meditated upon as the true basis of all the sounds. So the fourth, silence is the most important part of Omkar, which everybody misses out. Their whole idea is that how long breath I can take and can I stretch it longer than my neighbor? It's a competition. That's not the way to chant Omkar. Omkar you chant and give some pause after that, the silence, and hear the silence within yourself. In that silence, there should not be any form and name. You think from your point of view, how do you live? Everything in the world we recognize by form and name. Suppose there is no form and name on that chair. I won't recognize who is sitting. Can I? just remove the form and name. Nothing I cannot see, I cannot experience, therefore the world does not exist, I will say. Because I can't see form and name over there. So everything, Jagat Rupam is, I told, these are the five things. Amshakam is there in the world. One is Nama, Rupa. These are the lower things which is belonging to the world. And the first three things are Asti, Bhati, Priyam. Asti means it exists. Bhati means it is aware. Third is it experiences. Priyam is experiences. So Asti, Bhati, Priyam are nothing but the existence, the awareness of the existence and the experience of the existence. All three are there. Then comes the name and form. The moment these three previous ones are put into a name and form, the Jagat, all this world emerges on its own. So Nama Rupa is the one. So Omkar, the first three parts are having some Shabda, some sound is there. But the fourth one is absolutely silent, which is the Brahma Tattvam. The first A, U, are Jagat Tattvam. The silence, the fourth, is the Brahma Tattvam. When you meditate on that silence, how do you meditate? There is a trick. Don't supply words and forms to your mind when you meditate on silence. Listen again. Don't allow your mind to pick up any word or any form. That is the way to meditate on silence. Sit down now and tell that I will not supply any name, any form to my mind right now. And let us see what your mind is capable of thinking. Don't supply. Just tell yourself, I will not allow mind to take up any name or any form. Sit. 10 seconds, just do this. Okay. Did you realize that if you don't give name and form to your mind, it is incapable of thinking? It's trying to think, but you're cutting it off. You're saying, no, you can't pick up a word. This is the rule. This is the game. Rule of the game is you can't pick up any word, any sound, any form, nothing you can pick up. Now you think, you tell your mind. It's incapable of thinking then. But even that moment, are you not aware that you are present? You're aware, isn't it? Or you also stop having this awareness that you exist. Sounds don't exist there. Names don't exist there. Or forms don't exist in that silence. But you exist. You're aware that you are the one who is actually practicing this completely. So that awareness part is the Brahma Tattvam. The sound and the form part is the Jagat Tattvam. So the Omkara, the fourth aspect, has to be practiced like this. You chant Om and then leave the fourth empty. Aka is Amatra, it's called. Means there is no sound over there. Like in deep sleep, within you, there is no name, no form. Outside you, there will be a lot of noise. You'll be snoring and everybody will be troubled. But within you, though you are snoring, are you even aware that you are snoring? Not at all. When you wake up, people say, how much you snore? Did I snore at all? They have to record and show, this is how you are snoring. Why? Because you didn't even realize that you are snoring. Because Nama Rupa was deleted from your thinking. In fact, thinking itself was not there. You were there, but no thinking was there. Because thinking means name and form are required. Without name and form, thinking cannot happen. Without legs, can anybody move? Even if, however I want to move, if I don't have legs, I have to keep sitting in one place only. Likewise, name and form are like the two legs for mind to think. The moment you remove name and form from the mind and don't allow it to use any name and form, it is like lost both its legs. It cannot go anywhere. It has to simply sit. So the fourth in the Omkara is the most important part of the Omkara, which allows us to listen to that silence without thinking at all. And how do not think? How to not think? The moment a thought emerges means a sound, a name or a form emerges, cut it off. Consciously, I won't allow any thought, I won't allow any sound and name to come. I will remain silent. That is the practice of Omkara. So chant Om and then chant the fourth. Chant the fourth means simply stay silent. Don't be in a rush to start one more 21 times Omkara means, oh, in a great hurry. First Omkara didn't get over, second Omkara started off. No, so you have to chant Omkara with a gap. Om. So between two omkaras there has to be silence. And how do you imagine? From the silence is emerging the omkara. It is sustained and into the silence it's going back. Like the whole world emerges from God, it's sustained and it goes back into God. This is the practice of omkara. So practice like this, this one mantra is enough, that is what Yama is saying. One mantra is enough to take you all the way to the Nirguna Brahma, because you are chanting the, you are listening or you are meditating on the silence, which is the aspect of Nirguna Brahma. Nirguna means it has no qualities. Silence has no qualities. Is silence loud? Silence soft? Is silence sweet? Is silence harsh? Nothing. Silence is just silence. It doesn't have any aspects to it. A music can be loud, a music can be soft, a music can be sweet, a music can be harsh. Or sound or speech can be harsh. But silence cannot be. It is just silence. So through this sound, we are trying to meditate on the idea of what Brahman must be like. That it has no attitudes, no aspects, no name, no form. It is just an experience. Even in that silent mind, the awareness that you exist is there. But the moment the thought comes, I exist is this girl, cut it off. Because girl is a word and a form. You're not supposed to allow it during silence. Or if it comes, I am the teacher, cut it off. I am the chairperson, cut it off. Because all these are names and forms. Either name or form or both. I am meditating in Om, cut it off. Because that is also some words being supplied to your mind. So completely cut off the supply. Like when gas is there, you turn off the knob, no fire then. Like they turn off this knob of name and form during the silence, practice of silence. That is why Maunam is such an important practice, especially in Buddhism. Even in Hinduism, everywhere, Maunam is practiced very much. People will go away in clues they become and they retreat and they keep practicing Maunam for a couple of days on a continuous basis. Why? Because they don't want to identify themselves back again with the body, name, place, relations, forms. They want to identify themselves with the Nirguna Nirakara Brahman, which is the origination of everything else, and that is where we come from. All this Jagat is nothing but modification of that silence. All sounds are modification of silence. You understand that, isn't it? When you keep practicing Omkar like this, a time will come, you will be able to understand the significance of the silence. And because the silence has no name and form to it, you will realize that you are one with the same Brahman. That Brahman's nature is no aspect, so there is simply an awareness of its kind. So these are the four states of consciousness. I'm teaching you all this because the next shloka is getting very deep. Today's class might be one of the most important classes of Kathopanishad, because that is the key to the entire Kathopanishad, the shloka which is coming up now. So therefore, before that I'm explaining to you some. So these four things can be considered as four states of consciousness. And it's so simple to understand. The first state, it says that life is happening to me. Pay attention. Life is happening to me. Means I am the body and the life is happening to me today. I woke up and I'm eating and in me life is happening to me. That is the first stage. The second thought is life is happening by me. I am controlling life. I decided to eat breakfast today. I decided not to drink coffee today. Life is happening by me. It's under my control. Then when you go off to a deep sleep stage, has life left you? But neither you realize that you are alive nor you are controlling your life. Then life is happening through me, because I am not involved at all in deep sleeping. Did I put effort to deep sleep? No, it just happened to me. So life is happening through me, and the force is life is happening as me. I am the life. I am not the body to which the life is happening. I am not the mind by which life is happening. I am not even the subtle that state of deep sleep where the life is happening through me. I am the very life which is happening right now. First is the body level, where things happen on their own. You don't do anything for breathing. You don't do anything for making the heart beat or the blood flow or the stomach digest the food. Everything happens on its own. That is the body consciousness. Second level of consciousness is mind consciousness, where you say, to me, it appears that I am the one who is controlling my life. I decide what to think, not to think, what to eat, not to eat. Body is incapable. If I don't allow body to get up and go, body will not go anywhere. Therefore, I am the more important. The thinking is more important part than just having a physical body. So you identify yourself with the mind. But at deep sleep stage, your mind disappears. You're just lying there. Body is functioning. Mind has gone into deep sleep stage, where you can't even have a thought, you can't even decide to move, you can't even decide to dream. None of the decisions you can take at that stage, in deep sleep stage. But life is still happening. Life is happening, you're not dead. How it is happening? It is happening through you. You are just a channel. Life is the superior thing. You are just an inferior channel through which life passes. That realization comes there. And beyond that, you realize you are not different from life. But you are the life, because what was common in all the three things? Life alone was common. You thinking you are the body was one way of thinking. You thinking you are the mind is another way of thinking. You think you are the deep sleep stage, the Sushupti Avastha is your way of thinking. But one common thing all through was there was what? Life. So you identify yourself with that idea that you are that consciousness which makes you aware that you are awake right now, which makes you aware that you are dreaming, or which is there but you are not aware that you are deep sleeping. But consciousness is the one which flows through all the three phases. That's why Omkara, the fourth one, is this consciousness, pure consciousness without any modifications in it, like the silence. But without that, no experiences are possible. Neither the experience of waking is possible, nor dreaming is possible, nor deep sleep is possible without the fourth. Like without the silence, neither the loud sound is possible, nor soft sound is possible, nor sweet sound is possible. No sound is possible. The fourth one is the reason why all the three exist. If the fourth is taken off, all the three will disappear. Bulb may imagine electricity is happening to me, by me, through me. You can imagine. If there is no electricity, nothing is happening. Nothing is happening if there is no electricity in the circuit. This is the idea. So what happens in these states of consciousness? A very nice a little you understand. We all think, how do we explain who we are? First we say is, I am. From I am a woman. I am a man. I am a doctor, I am a teacher, I am a student, I am a son, I am a wife, I am a husband. All that is dependent on what? Suppose I remove the I am from this. Somebody comes to you, husband, you tell. What will he understand? Somebody comes, you say, wife. What do you understand? I am the wife, if you say, then they understand. Okay. Woman, man, whatever you say, intelligent, dull. What are you referring to? Whom are you referring to is the question they will ask. This intelligence, dullness, womanhood, man, husband, wife, child, teacher, whom are you referring to, they will ask. If you come to me, I simply said, teacher, what did you understand? Did you understand I am the teacher? Or did you understand I am thinking you are a teacher? Or do you understand that I am talking about somebody who is a teacher? Absolute no clarity at all. The moment I put I am, then all the definitions find their meaning. Without using the word I or the letter I cannot define anything in the life. The very basis of every definition is the idea that I am. So these four avasthas that we talked about yesterday, in Jagrut avastha, what is happening? I consciousness is there. I am awake. I am aware that I am sitting here right now. So I is the first idea of ourselves. Everybody who is born, first thing they learn is I. And the I is the idea that I exist. And if I exist with thoughts, it's called Jagrut avastha. See, I is on one side, another side are thoughts in the grid. If I exist with thoughts, it is called Jagrut avastha, wakeful state. Then you will say, no, sometimes I exist without thinking. Or sometimes I exist without the idea that I exist because I'm sitting in the class but I'm playing in my mind in the football field. Thoughts are there, but the I that I'm sitting here, somebody has to shake you up in the class. Otherwise you have gone somewhere. So you have thoughts, you are playing football, but you don't realize that you're sitting in the class right now. Though you're sitting in the class, but mentally you're in the canteen. So I consciousness is not there. Try to understand it with a little more detailed thinking. That when you sit in the class and your mind switches off from the lecture and goes off to the canteen, till somebody shakes you up, you don't realize that you're sitting. Otherwise, where was that I at that moment? As the body, the I was not there because you were mentally somewhere else. So thoughts were there in you, but the I consciousness was not there. I as the student in the class was not there, but thoughts were there. So that part is called the Swapnavastha. It's a similar thing like a dream state, where your mind is going on imagining things. So then a teacher, when you are sitting and putting your head and watching outside the window, what does the teacher say? What are you dreaming of? The idea of dream is thoughts are there, but I consciousness is not there. And the third one is deep sleep. In Sushupti, thoughts and I both are not because you slept off. In Turiyavastha, I alone is there, no thoughts are there. This is the fourth silent. So I'll repeat again slowly. In the Jagrata waking state, your identification with the body is there and also thoughts are there. In the dream state, what is happening? Your identification with the body is not there, but your thoughts are there. In deep sleep state, the last quadrant, fourth one down, is your identification is not there with the body, nor there are thoughts with you. Because you don't know you're a man or a woman when you're doing deep sleep. Do you realize you're a man or a woman? You don't know anything till you're woken up. But in Turiyavastha, which is the fourth, which is beyond the three, thoughts and all are not there, but that identification is there, that I exist, I am aware, I exist. This thought state is called Samadhi state. People talk about what these yogis do all the time, sitting in one place and holding their thoughts, making their mind empty. What are they trying to get to? They're going to get to a state where there are no thoughts, but the awareness of their existence is there. So what are yogis trying to do? Yogis are trying to reach a state where they know that they exist, but they don't want any thoughts to exist, so that they can experience the pure awareness, the fourth part of Omkara. What did you do in fourth part of Omkara? You don't want any thoughts. Because every thought disturbs your original state of silence, pure state of existence. It disturbs how I am the body, I am the mind, I am a student, I am a teacher, I have to write the exam, I have to sing a song today, I have to attend the class. All these are the modifications of the I. If I write, I am boy, I am teacher, I am a student, cut off all the student, teacher, everything, what is left? I am. So this grid said that I am is the consciousness, and the other part which modifies this consciousness is the thoughts. If I remove the thoughts, what is left is me, the true me, which is neither the body, which is in the waking state, it is not the dreaming mind, nor it is the ignorant deep sleep stage. It is pure consciousness, which is the fourth, which is what I am truly am. All the other things is not me. They are all modifications of me. When I start thinking with this consciousness, I become the waking person. When I think without the consciousness, I become the dreaming person. When I neither think nor I have the consciousness, I become the deep sleep person. And when I am none of the three, but I am aware I am the fourth. That consciousness is me. That is what called Asti, Bhati and Priyam. Asti means I am. Bhati means I know I am aware. I'm not dead or I'm not asleep. I am, I exist. And Priyam means I experience this awareness that I exist. All three. So this is the state of Brahma Rupam. The Omkara is such a powerful mantra because you can't just chant it. You have to chant with this thought process. A starts Jagrutavastha with thoughts. It's not me. Then U starts Swapnavastha, the mind state, with thoughts, is not me. Sushupti Avastha, deep sleep state, when there is no thoughts, neither the consciousness that I exist, that is also not me. Beyond all the three, the pure awareness of I am alone is me. This is Vedanta.